This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Under the Absolute Amir. Author: Frank A. Martin. Year: 1907. Chapter 1: On the Road. In the summer of 1895, the Afghan prince, Shahzada Nasrullah Khan, was the guest of the English government for 3 or 4 months, and he had been entertained and fêted and generally made much of while his visit lasted, and his return journey had been made pleasant by a stay in Paris, Rome, and Naples before going on by sea to Karachi and thence by rail to Chaman, the railway terminus close to the Afghan frontier on the Quetta side of Beloochistan. The Shahzada was met and entertained at the railway terminus by General Sir J. Brown, commanding the Quetta district, with other officers and officials, and afterwards rode on to his camp across the border, where he was joined by a multitude of troops and followers who had been sent by the Emir to accompany him on his further journey. I had accompanied the Shahzada, as he was commonly called in England, on his return from London, and rode with him through Kandahar to Kabul, and when he set out from his camp early the following day, I formed one of his retinue. It was near the end of October and late in the season, but the day we started was a very hot one, and grew hotter as we went on, and the multitude of horsemen who accompanied the prince caused clouds of dust to rise as they rode along and made it still more sultry and oppressive. The country looked very desolate and inhospitable, for on all sides stretched a large undulating sandy plain, bare of vegetation, save a few tufts of coarse grass here and there, and rocks jutting out of the plain in places, while in the distance were bare foothills and barren rocky mountains, and over all the sun threw its burning rays until the sand and rocks seemed to give out as much heat as the sun itself. There is no made road from Chaman to Kandahar, nothing but a track worn into the earth by the passing of caravans from time immemorial, and at places on the side of the track were the bones of horses and camels whitening where they had fallen. The prince and his retinue, however, rode along cheerfully, for they had returned safely through all the dangers of foreign travel, and had many tales of strange lands and stranger customs to tell their relations and friends when they got to Kabul, and had brought with them finely wrought produce of these lands to make presents of, and to trade with and reap much profit. In front of the Shahzada were two long lines wide apart of Usbeg lancers. At an interval on either side of him, and following the Usbegs, were two other lines of the bodyguard, the Risala Shahi, armed with sword and carbine, and better uniformed than the others, and following these were troops of sowars, who were roughly dressed and wild-looking, though not so wild-looking as the Usbegs with their sheepskin busbies, the hair of which falls about their faces and makes them look wilder than nature made them. The sowars' mode of keeping line would, perhaps, have offended a military eye, but they nevertheless looked very serviceable in case of need. Before all rode a man with a native drum strapped to the saddle in front of him, which he kept continuously tapping in time to his horse's hoof-beats. This is the custom used to signify the approach of a royal personage when traveling. Beside the prince ran a man carrying a huge gold-embroidered umbrella as a protection from the scorching rays of the sun, and around him were syces and foot guards, while a little in front were other syces leading spare horses. Behind rode attendants and the khans and chiefs who were accompanying him, and I rode with these and knew what it was like to ride in a cloud of dust which caked the perspiration on one's face and was so dense that the horses stumbled over stones in the road they were unable to see. Along the track, and stretching away into the distance both before and behind, were strings of camels and pack horses, each with its own dust cloud and accompanied by their drivers who were on foot. These carried the tents and baggage of this small army, and with each string of animals was a sowar or trooper, whose duty it was to see that there was no undue delay on the road and to ensure the full load reaching the next camp, for most of the pack animals were the property of men who make a trade of carrying goods, and these men are not averse to making a little extra profit when opportunity offers. It was with a feeling of thankfulness that I heard the prince order a halt for tea soon after midday, for my mouth was parched with heat and dust. We all dismounted by the side of a hillock and seated ourselves on the stones and rocks round about while tea was prepared, excepting, of course, attendants and soldiers, who are not supposed to feel fatigue. After drinking tea, the prince offered me a cigarette, and I may mention that he showed me many courtesies and kindnesses on the journey, and ordered fur-lined overcoats to be made for me by his tailors, saying that English coats were unsuitable for the extreme cold we should afterwards experience, and I appreciated his thoughtfulness in this very thoroughly afterwards. The Shahzada was a different being in his own country, not at all like the Afghan prince in London. After a short rest, the march was resumed and continued until camp was reached. The afternoon's ride was more pleasant, for the heat was less, and a track running over harder ground, the dust was not quite so much in evidence. At all of the villages we passed, the inhabitants were crowded outside the walls to see the Shahzada and his people, while the headmen of the village stood in front of the others, and as the prince came up, took off their turbans with both hands, and prayed for him and his safe journey. Outside most of the villages, long poles were fixed in the ground on either side of the track, with a string stretching across from top to top, and from the center of the string the Quran was suspended, wrapped in cloths. The prince and his followers, when passing under the Quran, stretched up their right hands and touched it, and then with that hand touched each of their eyes, their mouths, and hearts, saying a short prayer the while. After this, the Shahzada would stop for a time and talk with the headmen of the village, and then ride on. Two or three bands accompanied the party, and on the prince's arrival at each camping ground, they played the royal salute as he rode in. This was also done when leaving. At each camp also a large shamiana was ready, and there he would hold durbar, which all the chief men of the country round about attended, either to salam the prince or to receive payment for the provisions and forage supplied to the men sent on in advance to prepare everything against his coming. At many of the places stopped at were men who had come to meet those friends or relations who had been to England, but it was at Chaman that the Afghans first got news of their relatives. When first meeting a friend they embraced three times, first to the right, then to the left, and then to the right again, after which streams of question and answer follow. It was touching to see the eager questions after the triple embrace, and to see some turn away crying, possibly at the news of the death of a relative, or it may have been that they were overcome at meeting with friend or relative. While superintending the unloading of baggage from the goods train at the Chaman terminus, before crossing the frontier, I noticed the Kotwal, one of the prince's staff who accompanied him on his visit to England, sitting on some boxes and looking very glum. He knew sufficient Urdu to carry on a conversation, and so I asked what troubled him. He sighed and said that he had just heard that his brother in Kabul had been made prisoner, and now his own enemies, may their fathers be cursed, had taken advantage of his brother's downfall to poison the Emir's mind against him, and he was told that if he returned to Kabul, it was probable the Emir would kill him. So he had thought it over, and concluded that it was better he should go back to Karachi and stay there with some friends until he could return with safety, and he asked me to help him in getting away by the next train. To help in the running away of one of the chief officials of Kabul would have been a bad introduction for me to the Emir, and it seemed hard not to help a man to escape death, as he said, and he knew the Emir's ways. So, saying I would think it over and make inquiries about the trains, I left him, wondering how best to arrange the difficulty. I ascertained that there would be no train before nightfall, and at that time we were due at the Afghan camp across the frontier, so, as there was no necessity to take immediate steps in the matter, I went on with the work in hand. At lunchtime, the English-speaking native, who had charge of the catering and other arrangements in connection with the prince's reception at Chaman, came to tell me that the Kotwal had also approached him about running away, and what should he do? I recognized that there was no help at hand, and so I impressed on him that whatever was done, nothing must be known that we were concerned in the man's running away, pointing out the bad impression it would make on the Emir, and that the government would no doubt institute inquiries, and we should be blamed. So he went off and came back with the Kotwal, and for a long time talked to him in Persian, of which I had little knowledge then, and I believe persuaded him that it was better that he should go away that day to the Afghan camp and get back during the night or the following day, and he would leave one of his men to see him to Karachi. However, when I rode away that evening, the Kotwal rode with me, and we reached the Afghan camp together, and he was one of the prince's retinue when we set out next day on the road to Kandahar. Afterwards, although the prince received orders in Kandahar that he should be brought back to Kabul in chains, the Kotwal made his peace with the emir, and continued for some time in the enjoyment of his position, which included torturing and killing people in horrible ways, and the acquisition of wealth by bribery and extortion, so that when he died of cholera some 8 years later, he was possessed of several lakhs of rupees. The day he died, I overheard some soldiers gloating over the fact that that night, his soul would be roasting in hell, and I fancy some few thousand others derived consolation from the same thought, and knowing what I did of him myself, the fate the soldiers assigned him seemed not an improbable one. According to the Afghan theory, the soul of a man is judged the night of the day he is buried, hence the delight of the soldiers over what would take place that night after the judgment had been pronounced. The camp at each stopping place looked rather imposing, and gave the impression of an immense gathering, as, besides the prince with his retinue and soldiers, were the men in charge of the baggage animals, who of themselves formed a rather large company, for the camels alone numbered 6,500, so that the tents, horses, and camels covered a large tract of ground. After nightfall, all the fires at which the men were cooking their food showed up clearly, and each fire had its quota of men busily superintending the pots and cooking arrangements generally, while others were standing or squatting round, watching and waiting the moment when, all being ready, they might fall to. The noises of the camp at night were numerous, though there was never any rowdiness, for an Afghan crowd is the most orderly and quiet of any country, but there were the voices of officers giving orders, the squeals of horses fighting with one that had got loose, and there always seemed a loose horse about at night, the gurgling of the camels, the challenges of soldiers on guard in guttural Afghani, and the striking of gongs to announce the hour. I remember one night, or rather early morning, when the guard over the gong had evidently been asleep and waked up suddenly, hearing 16 strokes of the gong in rapid succession, although it was only 1:30. Whether this was the result of nightmare, or whether the man thought a little extra activity would better demonstrate his extreme wakefulness, I cannot say. We were 4 days reaching Kandahar, for only on one day was the march at all a long one, the rest being what they term king's marches, in contradistinction to caravan marches. King's marches being short ones, on account of the number of men, etc., to move. The distance from one camp to another is usually expressed as so many hours' journey. The horses on a journey go at a uniform pace, something between a quick walk and a jog trot to which they are trained, and at which pace they can, when in condition, cover 50 to 60 miles in a day, though it is not customary to push them to that extent, except in cases of necessity. Taking into consideration the mountainous description of country usually met with, the absence of proper roads, and the size of the horses, which average 13 to 14 hands, this is a fair distance. They have a unit of distance in Afghanistan called a crow, which is said by some to be equivalent to 1.5 English miles, but as there are no recognized number of gus, yards, to the crow, it assumes varying dimensions according to individual taste. I once received a firman from the emir, through the prince, to make a perambulating instrument for measuring roads, which was to show distances on the index in gus and crow, and I wrote the prince to let me know the number of gus in a crow that I might arrange the necessary clockwork. He replied that he had made inquiries, and the number given by different persons so varied that he had written the emir to fix a standard. But the emir fell ill just then, and the matter remained in abeyance, and the same indefiniteness still exists. The present emir has distances measured in yards and miles. Once when traveling from Kabul to Peshawar, and after being 7 or 8 hours in the saddle, I asked the sowars with me how far it was to the village by which we intended camping. One usually is rather interested in knowing how much farther one has to go after several hours riding. He told me that it was between 1 to 2 kro ahead, but we did not get to camp until after 3 hours further riding. So I henceforth made it a custom to inquire the distance in hours, and found it less disappointing. On arriving within a few miles of Kandahar, the prince was met by the general commanding that district, and the principal officers, who dismounted at a distance from him, and came up with heads uncovered. When they reached him, they kissed his foot, and then taking his hand between both of theirs, placed it on each eye in turn and kissed it also, this being the Afghan custom when acknowledging their chief or swearing allegiance. Near the city, the troops of the garrison were drawn up, together with the artillery, and the latter fired the royal salute as the prince rode up. The prince then inspected the troops and addressed a few words to them, after which, followed by all the officers and officials, he repaired to the masjid for prayers, while I rode on to the city to find the quarters which had been allotted to me. The road via Kandahar is not one which is often used when traveling from India to Kabul, the road from Peshawar through the Khyber Pass being the direct route, and the journey by that road occupies about 8 days when traveling with little luggage and doing forced marches, while the route via Kandahar and Ghazni takes 3 or 4 weeks. There are no roads for wheeled traffic, nor are there any railways, and one must either ride or be carried in a sort of sedan chair, suspended from the backs of 2 horses. The Afghan rulers are greatly prejudiced against railways, and if one but mentions such a scheme, ulterior designs are at once suspected. Yet a proper scheme of railways to open up the country would make it rich and prosperous, and do away with the present universal poverty and misery. The Shahzada, on leaving Kabul for England, had been sent via Peshawar by the late Amir, and arrangements had been made for him to return via Kandahar, in order that he might see as much as possible of the country. Since he came from Russia, a little boy of 9, he had never been more than a few miles out of Kabul, for the Amir did not encourage the members of his family to travel unless of necessity. The Amir also wished him to stop in Kandahar on his return journey to inquire into matters concerning its government, because for many years there had been complaints from the people of the oppression of the governors and absence of justice. I was told while in Kandahar that the Amir made the previous governors, when accepting office, sign a paper providing that, should they rob or oppress either rich or poor, they consented to be hanged, and it was significant that the last 3 or 4 governors had been hanged. The man who was governor when the prince arrived suddenly fell ill and died a few days afterwards, and there were not wanting those who suggested self-destruction in order to escape worse happening. Kandahar is situated in the middle of a fertile plain, or rather, the plain would be fertile if irrigated and cultivated as it could be, but when I was there, there was little cultivation or signs of it, although the rivers carry plenty of water. On account of the small amount of rainfall in Afghanistan, irrigation is necessary in order to make the land yield crops, and in some cases, to provide water for land which cannot be irrigated direct from the river. The people have sunk a series of wells leading from water-bearing strata to the land requiring irrigation, connecting the wells by underground ducts, the water from the last well being raised to the surface by means of a Persian wheel. This is a laborious process, and as the connecting ducts are not arched or protected in any way, the supply is frequently stopped by the earth falling in, and crops are ruined before the supply can be set going again. I was asked to propose an irrigation scheme by which the whole of the surrounding land could be put under cultivation, and gave my opinion, but, although the work was feasible, it involved too great an outlay for the exchequer, and the matter was dropped. The city is not a large one, and is surrounded by a high wall, which, together with most of the buildings, is built of mud and stone, or mud and sun-dried brick. The whole place is in a most tumble-down condition, having been partially destroyed several times during the wars of the past 20 years and not rebuilt. It gave one the idea that the inhabitants were in the utmost poverty, and although some of the better houses and masjids are built of small burnt bricks and lime, yet in all is the same appearance of dilapidation which made one think that the people were humbled and lacked the heart to put their city to rights. Some of the streets and the bazaars are raised above the surrounding land, so that one looks down into the tumble-down shops, where copper, tin, leather, and other trades are carried on in a small way. One thing that struck me particularly when riding through the bazaars was the small size of the donkeys, which are little bigger than a large mastiff. They are employed in carrying loads, and I saw many with such huge piles of grass on them that only the donkey hoofs and a small portion of his head was visible. Ripe cases for the intervention of the society for the prevention of cruelty to animals. I was lodged in a small house built in the form of a cross and consisting of one room only, branching out on four sides, this form being, I believe, copied from Russia. It was situated in the garden adjoining the house occupied by the prince, and as the weather was getting cold at night, it was a decided improvement on a tent, although the architect had forgotten to include a fireplace. From the roof of the house, I got a good view over most of the city, and could also see the minarets of the masjid, in which is a sanctuary where any man, whatsoever his crime, is safe when once inside. There used to be similar sanctuaries in some old English churches. The late Amir once told me a story of a mullah in Kandahar who had dubbed him a kafir, infidel, when inciting the people to rise against him. They had to make him out a kafir, as otherwise it is against the religious law for the people to rise against the king, who is also their spiritual head. When the ensuing rebellion had been put down, the Amir was told that this man had taken refuge in the sanctuary. Then the Amir, turning the tables on the man, said that the sanctuary was for Muslims only, not for such infidels as men who rose against their king, and taking his sword, he went to the masjid and killed the man in the very place. It was little that stopped Abdur Rahman in the pursuit of vengeance. Chapter 2 On the Road Continued. After spending a few days in the city of Kandahar, the prince went out to a garden a few miles up the river to spend a couple of days in fishing. On the evening of our arrival, the prince told his suite that the following day all must appear in Afghan costume, and that anyone who came in English dress would be thrown into the adjoining river. The river was a shallow one, so it meant a ducking only. One of the men there suggested that I should be included, but was ruled out on the grounds that I wore the costume of my country. In order to afford amusement and please the prince, one or two men did go the next day in English dress, and were ducked, much to the merriment of all there. About midday, the weather having cleared, the prince and the rest of us started up the river, walking along the banks, while horses were led by syces for fording branches of the river, or the river itself when required. Two fishermen, casting their circular nets as they went, waded up the river, the party on the banks keeping well behind them so as not to disturb the fish before the nets were thrown. The bed of the river was covered with shingle and stones, with boulders jutting out here and there, and the water did not seem to exceed more than 4 feet in depth at any place, and being the time of low water, it was perfectly clear. There was a good catch of fish, which in appearance very much resembled trout, some of them being 4 to 5 pounds in weight, but the flavor of the fish had little to recommend it. The circular nets used by the fishermen are similar to those used by natives in India. They are 10 to 14 feet in diameter and weighted round the circumference at short intervals with leaden pellets, while between the pellets are pockets into which a fish swimming under the net in an endeavor to escape gets his head, and his body too, if not a large one, and is so prevented from escaping. To the center of the net a long cord is attached. The method of using the net is this: the end of the cord is fastened round the right wrist by a slipknot, and the rest of the cord gathered up in coils which are held in the right hand. The net is then held up by the cord so that it may hang in regular folds, and one half of these folds are arranged consecutively over the left arm, and the rest over the right, both arms being held out to carry them, and care being taken to avoid one fold entangling with another. The hands grip the folds nearest them, and then, after one or two preliminary swings, the net is thrown forward and outward, in such manner as to spread out and cover as large an area as the net is capable of, before striking the water. On striking the water, the weighted periphery sinks at once and encloses any fish within its area. The principle of landing the fish netted may be explained by supposing a circular cloth, with its circumference weighted at short intervals, spread out on a table. If the center of the cloth is taken and slowly lifted, the circumference of the cloth will drag in over the table towards the center until it becomes massed together just before it is lifted clear. In the case of the net, the weights round the circumference press against each other sufficiently to prevent fish falling through while it is lifted clear of the water onto the bank. It is no easy matter to use this net without a good deal of practice, the gathering of the folds over the arms preliminary to throwing being particularly awkward, and seeming at first to require three hands at least. The Afghan fishermen are very expert in throwing it, and can make it assume circular, oblong, or triangular shapes, according to the requirements of the river or stream in which they are fishing, and the rocks and other obstacles it is necessary the net should avoid when cast. But that is a refinement in throwing, which requires some years' experience. In nets for catching large fish, the weights are necessarily heavier than those intended for small ones, but a couple of hours fishing with a light net will be found sufficient exercise for one day for those not accustomed to them. Those who find it necessary to fish for the sake of the catch and not for sport will find these nets useful. The prince, after spending a couple of days in the garden, returned to the city, but not liking the house he had occupied there, he went the next day to stop at the Munzil Bagh, a new palace the Amir had built a year or so before just outside the city walls. I was given a tent pitched in the adjoining garden, because the rooms of the place were large and few, and sufficient only for the accommodation of the Shahzada and his personal attendants. While here I fell ill with fever and dysentery, and having no English medicines with me I might have fared rather badly. The prince, however, on hearing that I was ill, sent his own hakim or doctor to attend me, and this man did his best and gave me every attention. I was not quite as grateful at the time as I ought to have been, for three times a day he brought me medicine in a 2-pint glass filled to the brim with some bitter concoction, and sat there while I drank it, and as part of his treatment was also to starve me until the disease passed, I felt in rather a hurry to get better. Towards the end of my illness, however, I persuaded him to send the medicine to me, and not to put himself to the trouble of bringing it, and then I found a convenient crack in the dry earth under my bed, which absorbed the bulk of the liquid better than I could, and I am inclined to think that taking medicine in the Afghan manner is more or less an acquired habit. When I was convalescent, this Hakim selected all food that was to be cooked for me, and did so in such generous quantities that, after my enforced fast, I was in danger of getting ill in other ways. I really ought to have been more grateful, for he was very conscientious, and liberal too, and took the greatest interest in my case. When I was well again, I rode about the country around a good deal, and found plenty of partridge and quail shooting, and I heard that deer could be got further away, but as it involved the trouble of camping out for a night or two, I did not think it worthwhile to try my luck, and camping out with a small escort was hardly advisable. One day I came across an abandoned gold mine, which I had previously heard the people speak of as yielding large quantities of gold in its time. A huge hole had been blasted out of the mountainside, and heaps of debris were scattered about, in some parts entirely filling up previous excavations. The quartz veins had been mined in all directions, but the gold had evidently been in a pocket, and there was nothing further to be had. I had a great desire for an opportunity of thoroughly trying the place myself, and while I pottered about, the sowar escort with me broke up lumps of quartz to see what they might find. Gold exercises a fascination over most people. A sowar escort of 7 men, with their dafedar sergeant, had been appointed to attend me wherever I went from the day I crossed the frontier, and as the penalty, should a fanatic attack and kill me, was death to themselves, they kept very close to me and left nothing whatever to chance. The prince spent about a month in Kandahar, and was getting rather gloomy at the thought of being kept there for the winter, for it was getting on towards the end of November, when one evening I went to pay my compliments, or salam him as they call it, and met him coming into the Durbar room as I got there. I saw that he was very pleased and excited, and he called out, "How do you do?" Almost all the English he knew, when he saw me, and shook hands, which was a thing he seldom did, and then told me that the Emir's firman had been received, and he was to go on at once to Kabul. I made a remark about it being rather cold weather for traveling, and he assured me pleasantly that on the march it would be 20 times colder than in Kandahar. As the water in my tent froze every night, I saw nothing to congratulate myself upon. However, the prospect of being on the move again was exhilarating. That evening the prince had some musicians brought in. They played upon instruments made of some sort of cane or bamboo, which rather resemble the flute, and although Afghan music is not usually soothing to the Western ear, I found the music these men played rather pleasant and lively. The instruments they used are peculiar to Kandahar, I was told, and the prince wanted one of the men to accompany him to Kabul, but the man was not attracted by the idea.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.